Pull up in a four-door Audi. Dropped a milli on my bus and my Audi. All the champagne got me feeling rowdy. Windows down cause the shit is kinda
cloudy. Hey, what's up guys? It's Nadia Nakai, aka Braga, and this is the Weekend Turn Up. Tell him to bring out my carriage, baddest bitch, you cop to bed. So the name Braga is actually funny because it was from Gemini's song Raga Raga. One of the Fast and the Furious movies, there was this drug lord leader named Braga. So and in Raga Raga, I say, I'm a boss, call me Braga. And then everybody just started calling me Braga. I think what inspired me to get into the hip-hop industry was just my family. My family's always been really musical, not necessarily being the musicians, but have always been listening to music. I grew up listening to, like, Erykah Badu, UB40, Guns in the Ghetto, Indie Irie, Lauryn Hill. I got exposed to from my mom. Sade, all of Sade, Phil Collins, Jamiroquai, M People, like those are the people that I grew up listening to, and they were very like musical. So I think I was always influenced by that. And then growing up in the way that I grew up with Zimbabwean heritage, I was very influenced with dancehall artists like Ware, Buffalo Soldier from Zim, Ware is from Kenya, and Prezo is also from Kenya where I did my high school, and that's kind of like how I started. Music was very danceable influence. A different class, yeah. And I'm quick to cut these fake niggas off, yeah. Braga. Like songs that I did myself, like The Man that I featured Casper on, is kind of like where I started like feeling like this is who Nadia Nakai is, this is the tone, and this is what I want to be able to portray when I go out there. Yeah, so I'll definitely say The Man was like where I felt more comfortable in being bad. The experience was really cool because like it actually came about from a very big hip-hop opinion leader in South Africa, Slicker on Life. He had been working with Sports Scene on various projects, and I think they had their collaboration with Nasty C, and they were looking for somebody that was gonna represent the female side, and he approached me and he was like, you know, I see that you've done your fashion range on your own, but like there's this opportunity. And he really was bridging the gap between me and the Sports Scene team, which is really cool. And from there, I've always been into apparel, I've always been into clothes, and the nice thing about it is that I was allowed to be extremely involved in it. I traveled with the whole Webat design team to London to go check out trends. And then I went to Madagascar to check out the factories. And I went to Mauritius and to check out like the denims and all of that stuff. There were so many like travel plans that we even had for this year as well. So what I'm saying is like, that's the nice thing about working with Sports Scene and the team, is that they're so open to all of my ideas. They're so open to genuinely being collaborative. They don't just want me to have my name on their clothes. They also, I feel like, it really inspired the fact that I really enjoy doing it. It's not like I'm doing it for the check. I'm doing it for the passion. You know what I mean? And they're amazing to work with, which makes it a lot easier. Reebok, I'm representing their brand. I'm their brand ambassador. Whereas Red Bat, it is mine as well. It's a collaboration. When I spoke to the marketing team at the beginning, the reason why that they do these collaborations with Red Bat is purely because they, not purely, obviously they want to build their Red Bat brand, but one of their main objectives is that when people walk into the Sports Scene store to buy a Red Bat Nadia Nakai collaboration, and they see Reebok and they see the other brands, and they're like, okay, I'm gonna pair it with these sneakers. They want people to walk into the store and see their other brands that they have in the store, which is kind of the main objective. So it makes complete sense and complete synergy for me to be able to do both. Grew up on the same street, popping up like spam, trying to get a retweet. I'm sitting here. Signing to Def Jam is super exciting. Obviously, it's something that was integrated through Universal, which is the label that I was already with Family Tree. And Def Jam is like the umbrella that's under the Universal umbrella that's representing most of the urban hip-hop acts that are under Universal. Which is super exciting because being signed to or being part of the Def Jam division of Universal is exciting because Def Jam had always been a hip-hop pioneer when it came to music, you know? And like, I was the biggest fan of Ludacris, and when he did sign the Disturbing the Peace label to Def Jam, it just felt like everything just got amplified and everything was just like this bigger movement. And then you have like LL Cool J, who was like so sexy. So I had like that sexy period, like that feel of, oh, sexy boy, oh my gosh. And then I went to that point when I was like about thugs, I was about gangsters. And then DMX was also Def Jam. So for me, like, it was like everybody that I really messed with growing up happened to be under Def Jam, and I felt like that became like the hip hop fraternity. Like, that is where you had to be if you were serious about hip hop, you know. And also, like, I would see so many cool music videos and I watched them like on TRL, and at the end there would always be like a Def Jam logo, and those kind of things like really created like a nostalgic like connection for me. So that's why I'm really excited to be a hip hop artist in Africa and having that kind of like bridge now. It feels like the way that Universal was a bridge to the Universal Global, it's like now there's a feeling of a bridge connection between Def Jam and Def Jam Africa and like Def Jam International. It's a lot more attainable. And actually, the funny thing is that before lockdown, I was actually supposed to go to the Def Jam offices and have a whole meeting there and have some studio sessions set up there. The album is gonna be 1 year on the 29th of June. And like I never felt the pressure to drop an album. I was always like doing my career and doing well at it and getting endorsement deals and getting booked without an album. And releasing an album was a serious achievement for me because I had to buckle down and really work extremely hard to do it and really work really hard to make sure that it's good and make sure that I'm giving what the fans have been waiting for the longest time. And I feel like I did that with the album. I feel like I really impressed a lot of people. I turned critics into supporters when they listened to it. People started to believe in me more because there was a body of work that genuinely was great. And I'm confidently saying because my album is really good, you know? And that's the exciting part about it. But I still feel like as a female artist in the game, it's so hard to still convince people to want to listen to our female narratives. Like, the people get excited. And I'm not talking about like my peers. Like, my peers support me. My peers will listen to my project. They've known me for long. And like, even my launch was amazing because everybody really came out to support me, which I'll appreciate every single day. But I'm talking about like the actual listeners and the fans, because I feel like they get more excited when like a Ricky Rick or Nasty C or Questa is about to drop a project, or Shane Eagle, or, you know, because they feel like hip hop has to be like the pioneers of hip hop are males, you know? I feel like women should be excited to listen to female projects because we are speaking about your narrative. We're speaking about your perspective. And guys should be excited to listen to our narrative because you might be able to understand your girlfriend better. There's so much more that you can learn from a woman, to be honest, because we're a lot more vocal and we're a lot more deep and we're a lot more vulnerable. You know, like, there's a lot of like content that you can get from us, but I still feel like an essay, a Cardi B releasing a project and Nicki Minaj releasing a project will get that attention a lot more than a Nadia Nakai releasing a project or a Rouge releasing a project. There's still a lot to go, and I can see it from the numbers. Yes, people are buying it, but I can see it's not the same as if Nasty dropped, you know. So that's what I'm still trying to work through. So my manager is my best friend, so like it's so like dope when you can work with somebody that like knows so much about you that there's things that I don't even have to say that she would just understand. I think also like working with women for me is like, it's hard to explain how, like, if you're a female artist, there's so much more that goes into a girl. It's not about just getting up and doing the job. It's about literally like, how is she emotionally? What day of her cycle is she in? Has she eaten? Like, who's missing? What's happening with her boyfriend? And like, because all of that really can affect like the end result. Hey, let's go. I think the biggest advice that I would definitely give females that are getting into the game, or girls or women, is trust your instinct. Like, the biggest thing I felt like, one of the biggest mistakes that I did at the beginning of my career is really put everything that I had to do into a guy, like, or into guys' opinions, because I felt like guys knew better than me. So therefore, if I felt like I wanted to release this type of song, it might not be a good idea because this man said don't do that. And I feel like
I needed to trust my instinct, and people, like, people will come to you and say, no, your sound should be like this. And it's most likely a guy that's going to say that to you. Like, your sound should sound like this, and your sound, you should be like this. And I'm not saying don't be a person that can take information and learn from others, but you need to be a little bit more wiser and also trust yourself. Trust yourself in the sound that you want to make. Trust yourself in the type of music you want to make, who you want to collaborate with. Don't give all your power and all your decision making to someone else, because then years will go past and you'll be like, damn, I wasted a lot of time. Because then you're going to get to a point where you lose like 4 or 5 years of your career, and then eventually you're on your own, everybody's left, and now you're forced to do the things the way you want to do it. And I'm telling you, the way you want to do it is always going to work out, because it's the most authentic. Like, you're doing it for yourself, and yourself is always going to be the most authentic, and people are going to gravitate to that.
Pull up in a 4-door Audi, drop a milli on my bus and my Audi.